Welcome to DivCasts from the University of Chicago Divinity School. For more of our podcasts and information about our terms of use, please see our website, divinity.uchicago.edu/podcasts.
Good afternoon. I'm Miriam Verneau, a PhD candidate in theology here at the Divinity School and one of the co-organizers of this conference. It is my great pleasure to introduce today's keynote speaker. My fellow conference co-organizer, Dr. Joshua Daniel, will moderate the questions after Professor Fishbane ends his comments. Professor Michael Fishbane earned his PhD in Biblical Studies from the Department of Near Eastern and Judaic Studies from Brandeis University. He was appointed to the faculty of Brandeis while still a graduate student and eventually named Samuel Lane Professor of Jewish Religious History and Social Ethics. In 1990, he joined the faculty of the University of Chicago as a Nathan Cummings Professor of Jewish Studies in the Divinity School and in the college. He is also a lecturer in the law school. In 2012, he was named Distinguished Service Professor. Professor Fishbane specializes in biblical studies from the ancient Near East forward, especially the entire range of traditional Jewish interpretation of scripture in all its cultural and spiritual phases, from antiquity to the modern period. The history of Jewish mysticism and its literature is also among his strong interests. He has just completed a multi-level commentary on the Song of Songs, which incorporates all Jewish interpretations over the past 2,000 years. He is presently writing a book on Jewish liturgical poetry. Professor Fishbane has authored many monographs among these biblical interpretation in ancient Israel, published by Oxford University Press in 1985. His Samuel and Althea Stream lectures were published under the title of The Kiss of God, Spiritual and Mystical Death in Judaism by the University of Washington Press in 1994. He's also the author of The Exegetical Imagination on Jewish Thought and Theology, published by Harvard University Press in 1998. Biblical Myth and Rabbinic Myth-Making, published by Oxford in 2003, and Sacred Attunement and Jewish Theology, published by the University of Chicago Press in 2008. Professor Fishbane has been awarded a Guggenheim Fellowship, among other major grants, and has twice been named a Fellow of the Institute for Advanced Studies at Hebrew University. He was elected to the American Academy of Jewish Research in 1992. On several occasions, he's been invited to give lecture series, including the Gerson Cohen Memorial Lecture at the Jewish Theological Seminary of America in 2000, and the Lewis Jacobs Memorial Lecture at Oxford University in 2011. In 1986, he won the National Book Award, Jewish Book Award for scholarship, and in 1994, he won the National Jewish Book Award again, this time for Jewish Thought. In 2005, he was awarded a Lifetime Achievement Award for contributions to Jewish scholarship by the National Foundation for Jewish Culture. Professor Fishbane's scholarly work has been written up in the latest edition of the Encyclopedia Judaica. In 2013, he was elected to the American Academy of Arts and Science. Please join me in welcoming Professor Fishbane.
Thank you very much, Miriam. Thank you also, Josh, for all the invitation and also for all the kindnesses that you've extended. It's a pleasure to be here and to talk about this very important subject. I have entitled it Plumblines in the Vastness, Measures Without Measure. The invitation to address you today includes an inherent demand: absolute theological honesty. For as a particular provocation, the planners asked us to consider the following issues: the relationship between God and the good, the possibility of a theological ethic, and the horror of evil with God in mind. Each topic calls for serious consideration. Taken together, they require a bracing reconsideration of our intellectual and religious heritage. An additional request forces the point, since it asked us to rethink these matters in the light of scripture and tradition, surely a tough task in our dark and muddled times. So how might one respond? I, for one, hear these challenges as a contemporary person and as a Jew. As a person and a Jew, I hear the primordial question, where are you, with renewed force? It asks, where do you stand or hide before these grave issues? What can you say in a century of mustard gas and Cyclone B, with death camps in Europe and Siberia, genocidal butchery in Bosnia and Rwanda, and brutalities that rage as we speak in Central Africa and Syria? For most perpetrators, biblical scripture and tradition are meaningless scraps, or their teachings are mocked by perverse and self-serving exegesis. One can only gasp. All the theological air seems sucked from our lives, with no solution in sight. Was Nietzsche right? Does an insane laughter rattle down to hell? These are difficult matters, so let me reformulate the questions again for you and myself. Is there a conception or sense of God that is credible for thought and life and worship in our time of inexhaustible evil and technological hubris after Auschwitz and Hiroshima, as if this after was not still present, day in and day out? Further, can such a sense of divinity, within being or beyond being, take your pick, limit this evil or hubris in any way, with even a still small voice in the human heart? And finally, can the Bible or its traditions offer any resource for us in this process without entangling us in hermeneutical knots or leave us hanging by some verbal thread? All told, the challenge is God because of evil and technology, and ethics because the ground seems groundless, and also scripture itself because its voice is muffled by a mute and unwritten vastness which seemingly mocks the spoken written text of the Bible. Time and life press upon us, so what I offer you now is a personal statement, brief but forthright, in the hope that it will fall favorably on your hearts, similarly heartbroken and still groping for Sinai. We must start once again from our all too human ground. A first reflection. I must speak to you in the first person to demonstrate the task of the thinking self, as I understand it, to present to you the voice of a person who, like yourselves, begins and remains ontologically smothered by the swirl of existence, and one who repeatedly seeks some breathing room for values and moral action. How does it go for such a person who is embedded in this swirl even in moments of spiritual transcendence? How may it go for us who perceive evil in ourselves and in others and seek ways to resist this force, both to bolster our moral will and to confirm the significance of moral acts? In formulating my thoughts, I shall take up a threefold meditation, whose distinct domains reflect our multifaceted life in the world and desire to live meaningfully within it. I believe these domains to be both intertwined and structurally related, but I shall take them up separately. I do so both for analytic clarity and because they engage the self independently, according to our separate life concerns and levels of consciousness. The first domain is that of the world, and it involves our perceptive engagements with things and persons. The second domain is that of texts, and it involves our reflective encounters with formulations of words and values. And the third domain is that of God, and includes our various apperceptions of divine transcendence, such as they are. These three registers thus engage our natural being, our cultural selves, as well as our theological aspirations. They mark off three spheres of perceiving and enhancing the good in reality, for disregarding its potential through neglect, or destroying it through evil, and for living with scriptures and a transcendent horizon, each of which may inspire a heightened awareness of our moral choices latent in the forms of existence. Neither the world nor text nor God are impassive bystanders in this process. Each is affected by the human spirit in ways estimable and otherwise. Our moral will and cultural traditions may foster the good or crumble without strength. And then the world and texts and divine dimensions are reciprocally impacted. So we must do the best we can. Nothing is simply given, but rather involves a seeing and receiving for better or worse. We must recognize our many entwinements and not take them for granted. This said, let me turn to level one, the natural self. We begin in the swirl of the world, entwined in relation to things or persons as they are perceived or conceived. These things and persons make claims upon me and direct my body and mind in their direction. But this is not a relationship between two separate spheres, self and world. Rather, from the outset, what I perceive visually and tangibly is already infixed within me. My personal self is relationally impacted by some otherness, which simultaneously constitutes my selfhood from within, prior to all reflection. I am therefore not somehow thrown into world reality as a being who must only then assess his ontological condition, but I actually find myself within a myriad of pulsing sensations with which I vitally engaged which I am vitally engaged from the outset. I shall call this primary vibrancy our onto-vitality. For our life-serving energies are fundamentally entwined with living realities of many sorts, for food, for stability, for companionship, and so on. We thus adjust our existence to many other factors whenever these matters impact our physical or mental awareness. Internal and external realities intersect. I am within the world even as it is within me. Hence, we begin with a primordial swirl, with flashes of value being features of worth, whether positive or negative, in our perceptual field, and then make certain evaluations on the basis of personal need, experience or memory, deposits of lived tradition, individual or collective. These choices have their own phenomenological character. They constitute what I would call our onto-hermeneutical condition. This term, an extension of our onto-vitality, denotes all our estimations, judgments, and correlations we make in the midst of our life situations. These determinations are alternatively deliberative or spontaneous in nature, as we coordinate ourself with some perceived other. The very capacity to do so, to calibrate or concoct solutions, is encoded in our genetic condition or physical nature long before the revelation of things to our consciousness. Seemingly from the beginning, this tradition is inherent and present, such that my onto-hermeneutic engagements are fundamentally entwined with my onto-vitality. helping me discern the pangs of hunger and where I may go for help, be it initially the smell and feel of a breast, or subsequently the smell and feel of objects I may recognize or recall, helping me discern the difference between a stick and a snake for my protection, or also helping me discern when an object is a tree with branches or a person with outstretched arms, with diverse benefits in each case. And because of the entwinement of these two ontological forms, the vital and the hermeneutic, I am located within an ontological circle immediately, even pre-reflectively. My life is thus affected by primary engagements long before I have any awareness of the phenomena pressing upon me and eliciting my responses through the impressions they affect within me. Focused on matters of worth, primary and secondary issues of value, I claim them and am claimed by them simultaneously. How I deal with these claims determines my being and my personality. For the mode of acquisition may be aggressive because of inherent needs, deceptive because of perceived scarcity, or mindless or thoughtful depending on my spiritual capacity at the moment. Hence, I am tested at every turn. Every act is charged with onto-vitality and onto-hermeneutics and hermeneutical significance, and all matters of physical worth and ethical value are interrelated, oscillating for privilege or priority and making claims upon my character. The good and goods and evil and evaluations are thus not simple matters for people like us, embedded in the world with needs and desires and memories. But there is more, one more decisive factor that affects my ongoing evaluations. I refer to the crises or ruptures in the flow of routine and happenstance. I call these ruptures caesuras or breaks because they may also open our minds to our primary human condition and allow us to perceive something of our fundamental onto-hermeneutic nature, beings who turn the swirl of experience into components that mask the fragility and indeterminateness of life, transforming raw revelations into tame traditions about the nature of things. So the question is, can we allow the very tremendum of this disruption to be taken to heart and mind? Can I allow myself for the briefest moment to stand silently within this awesome caesura which sunders our hermeneutic presuppositions and sense the reality of my hermeneutic will as itself a disruption of being and allow that awareness to make a claim upon me? And if so, I may understand through some leap of intuition that there is a more primordial claim of world being as such that may affect me even prior to all the particular claims of my life, and even before I become a moral imperative, one that addresses me and commands concern for how I act in the world. If this may miraculously happen, such radical caesuras may open our hearts towards the whole world order and cultivate an ethical disposition, attuned to a heavenly no, resounding through the vitalities of existence, intoning restraint and humility before the great manifold of which we are a part. But not all caesuras are alike. Some are relatively easy to fix by finding the right piece to reconfigure the shattered jigsaw puzzle of our lives. Human ingenuity invents many ways to close these gaps, though it may also happen that our mind's eye may skim over these lacunae and disregard them like some cognitive blind spot. After all, we have our precious networks of meaning to maintain. However, there are other ruptures that cut to the bone and open wounds so devastating and inexplicable that they weaken our resilience and energy, or render the lexicon of reasons dyslexic. And then our words turn into a primal shriek, echoing everywhere as we wander the world with shriveled hearts. Insurance agents called natural disasters acts of God. How theologically considerate of them. But even these providers of all state guarantees bite their tongue before human evil and raw brutality. So what is there to do when all our hermeneutic dexterity seems a mockery and without meaning? Then things may rattle everywhere, and we are thrown asunder upon minimal acts, small gestures which offer consolation, or the sense that life has significance when shared in love and consideration. On such occasions, might some hint be heard that these minimal deeds are not vacuous and vain, but real truths intuited from the inscrutable depths, and may offer moral measures to guide our lives. If and when we perceive this, faced with faceless horrors, we have been claimed once again, perhaps when least expected. And then in the silence, something says do or do not, like a transcendent call to conscience or moral strength, and we are saved from the abyss. Who speaks? Let Nietzsche answer this too, for he said, don't ask, just receive. With this moral possibility of our natural selves, we have completed our first series of reflections. In the process, we have broached topics in the natural domain of our lives that will recur in other forms as we proceed in the next two meditations. The second reflection. Level two, the cultural self. We never escape the world. It is our primary ontological condition. But we are not also limited by sights and sounds. Other readings of experience are embodied in texts, which offer diverse expressions of our subjective and spiritual existence, and stylized articulations of the tasks and forms of culture. Over time, these features interpenetrate, and then the textual objectifications become directives for one's life in the world, and the statements may formulate new shapes of subjective possibility. Ontovitality and ontohermeneutics thus conjoin here in productive ways, variously energizing or enforcing one another. Such are the dialectics of cultural hermeneutics. Now primary speech becomes second-order locutions, and second-order language becomes primary through new interpretations. We read as we live, with multiple loops of entwinement. The words of texts inscribe our soul, and we envision experience through diverse literary filters. Slowly, we may even become embodiments of these inscriptions as we internalize the interpreted traces of our verbal traditions. In such ways, we rise above the swirl with a reflective consciousness that deals with the caesuras of reading and life in one way or another. Considered formally, textual caesuras primarily instantiate gaps between one word and the next, as readers try to make sense of a text, given its rendition of experience and our literary competence or life experience. Beyond this formal level, other caesuras occur when the reader confronts gaps between the values of a text and those in one's heart, particularly when one's moral sensibility has been shaped by this very text. Suddenly, disjunctions mark off older virtues from new sentiments and values. We work at these matters all the time, sometimes to keep the text in historical perspective, and thus at moral bay. At other times, we engage in radical interpretation or harmonization, hoping these moves will conceal the contradictions. But textual and personal horizons don't always converge, and then we try to live with bifocal perspectives or just move on. But not all texts are the same. Some even proclaim special privileges of voice and value. Heaven or transcendent truth is their homeland, so they say, and their guardians use every means to shape earthlings in their image. There are many reasons why people accept this proclamation. One of them is surely that people doubt what they see when doubts harass them. So they gladly prefer exegetical lenses polished by their priestly opticians, who claim that their glasses can correct the apparent caesuras that distort the nexus between life and texts. And then, lo and behold, all the moral gaps are shown to be mere misprisions in the eye of the beholder, and the text is saved along with faith. Given these results, is it any wonder that these exegetical practitioners use strong institutional claims to protect their hermeneutical product? A lot is at stake, so much so that many religions argue loud and long over the truth of their exegesis, even unto death. Just look at the evil that has been wrought by the presumptions of such interpreters, who turn minimal textual possibilities into maximal assertions of truth. In the process, the texts become mute, and all that remains is the chatter of pompous ventriloquists. However, corrupt textual exegesis is one thing, and misguided reasons for the caesuras of life quite another. Suffering can induce all kinds of solutions. Some therefore conclude that it is best to keep such speculations under lock and key, stuffed into a Pandora's box. Why ask for trouble? Why risk theological anomie? But the need for meaning pushes against the lock, and we ask, do evil and suffering come from some misbegotten human will? Or are they rather God-born, in some sorry sense or other? Only heaven knows, or so the book of Job suggests. But on earth, assumptions run wild. Every possibility is tendered, but no argument holds firm. Sprung from our empty hearts, the contentions turn into vacuous platitudes. It is therefore of greatest merit that guardians of the ancient Israelite heritage kept this book in the canon. But they were not alone. Keepers of other great cultures also took the risk of holding their values to the harshest light and allowed their unsettling formulations to remain as sources of instruction for later readers. Think for a moment of the Iliad and how it presents the complex relationship between family life and heroic ideals, between death and fame, or between personal pride and collective glory, and consider these matters without any conclusion and with no consolation greater than the balm of beautiful language depicting brutality and carnage. If this book's pedagogical goal was to teach ancients about the tragic relationship between destructive vainglory and the constructions of culture, so be it. But it is certainly a puzzling piece of Bildung to suckle the young, as has been our wont since its study was revived 2 centuries ago. I'll say no more. But let me rather consider Job and the book in his name. What does it dare do? It dares let the snakes of the cultural unconscious, or not entirely unconscious, come to the fore and pour venom into our bewildered hearts. Job lamented after his tragedy, "What I feared, what was of the deepest and most suppressed anxiety, va'asher yagorti, has surfaced and come upon me, yavoli." Surely Job had some inkling, and surely the author of Job had more than this inkling. As mentioned, the text is replete with all kinds of arguments and solutions which echo centuries of covenant theology, as recorded in the Pentateuch and Psalms and Proverbs and the prophets from Amos to Ezekiel. They all ask, why suffering? And what sense does it make? Is it some kind of warning or just tough love, a kind of justice beyond our ken? Take your pick. It's all there, with little resolve. Our chinks of pain widen the icy silence of heaven. Bold reasons wither. Nothing remains but a spate of endless speculations. The book of Job brings all this to the fore through a cacophony of rhetoric that hardly knows what it's talking about, even as we know from overhearing the open scenes in heaven. Who could have invented such a plot, if not a writer sunk in theological perplexity? Is not his voice the voice of Job himself? Has he not used Job like an alter ego to proclaim his own anguish? For Job is portrayed from the outset as one who lived on the brink of religious anxiety, filled with the suspicion that the dots do not connect. And so he filled his life with rituals and moral deeds and intervened in the life and the rights of his children, lest they did not perform the duties with a perfect heart. Surely Job could not suspect these possible troubles if a psychological tear had not already rent his mind. This is initially expressed by the thought that perhaps, ulai, his children needed his help. And again later, when we learn that despite the horrors, Job, quote, did not sin with his lips. The inner world of Job's concerns was not a secret to the author, and soon he lets the cat out of the bag. With a growing crescendo, the cry of Job's anguish fills our ears, and the author brings him to the same fissure that rips his own thoughts. But this takes narrative time, a time that the protagonists and we readers need in order to grasp the limits of language in times of sorrow. We thus have to enter along with Job and his interlocutors into the remarkable ontovitality of the human spirit, which projects solutions and meanings with unending pathos and desperation, which refuses to give up or slide into silence, and which shores up the caesuras of sorrow with endless interpretations to our ontohermeneutic glory and inevitable despair as well. What does Job or anyone learn from suffering? Three things at least. There is radical diminishment, fragility of the body, and the role of tradition during disaster. Let us consider each in turn. Why diminishment? Because in the course of suffering, there is a loss of ability and control, including all those things and persons that comprise our sense of self. The horizon of the world contracts, and there is a draining of fulfillments. In the case of Job, he lost his family and possessions and the health of his body. He felt like a living death, deprived of the givens, trying to buck up bravely. He was virtually unrecognizable to himself within and without. His wife told him to curse and be done with it. His friends just put their hands over their mouth. In such a state, one may wish never to have been born, for to be alive is to feel the diminishments of loss. And then there is bodily fragility. Why? Because the blows of loss are all wounds in the heart and mind, most of all and first of all in the mind, but also in the sudden and inescapable sense of being encased in a violated part of oneself. No buffer protects against the onslaught. Mental anguish permeates the body, and reciprocally, physical fracture cripples the mind. In the case of Job, his heart beat bravely while everything else collapsed. His loss was physical pain and mental anguish. And for him to sit in the dust, betocha efer, was to become like the ashes themselves. Job's only recourse was to maintain his integrity, since this was the only reality that might counter the hurt of his body and mind. One who suffers in the flesh is acutely aware how easily horror can ruin one's spiritual self, and the great struggle ensues to preserve one's self-image and sense of virtue. And finally, there is the topic of tradition. Why? Because just this offers an external source of meaning and coherence, a framework of stability and justification. In Job's case, his sense of values learned from the tradition was and remained the minimal point. So it was from this point that he expressed defiance and whatever mental clarity he could muster. But the point repeatedly narrowed as the tradition closed off round about him, when all his contentions were dismissed by his friends. I think this was Job's greatest terror and horror. Tradition was turning into rhetoric, and its terms were becoming desperate and devious, used to foil and parry in attempts to be more right than wrong, or shore up caesuras with sandbags of self-righteousness. This is most evident in the vituperations of Job's interlocutors, but it shows itself with Job as well. We may imagine that his self-vindications echoed in mocking irony while still in his mouth. Take the following three examples from chapter 7. Suddenly, while bemoaning his mortal condition, which swings like a shuttlecock between the nothingness of today and tomorrow, Job asked God, "Am I the sea or the dragon that you muzzle me with physical sorrows and terrors?" With this query, he alludes to God's vaunted might in catching and killing primordial sea monsters, but now pushes the point that God's power seems beyond all bounds, without proportion or sense. Do his deeds really threaten the creation? The battle is absurd, and God most of all, for turning his case into a theomachy. Then Job adds another joust, asking, "What is man that you raise him up and put your mind on him, that you seek him every morning and examine him by the minute?" Surely you hear in this protest an ironic reuse of Psalm 8, where this language was used to exalt humankind through exclamations of rhetorical wonderment, not dire sarcasm, as in this case. And finally, Job asks, "If I have sinned, what have I done to you, O watcher of man? Why will you not bear my transgression and forgive my sin?" All the terms of this outburst invert the language of Exodus 34, 6 and 7, which articulates the divine attributes of mercy and forgiveness. By so baldly traducing tradition in these instances, Job has trashed the only language that might give theological comfort and meaning. So what is left? What is left when you perceive the hollowness of your religious proclamations and turn them inside out? What words are left to rebuild a life? What traditions remain when one's arguments mock God and every sense of providential proportion? Not much. But some shreds remain, and they're held tight, for insight takes time, and so the author of Job keeps up the din of desperate arguments and adds some new speeches to boot, to make sure that the caesural shrift that racks his heart bursts Job's as well. And then suddenly a new discourse occurs. It is a speech that comes from God Almighty, and with it our author reveals the insight that inspired his own heart and offered consolation from the depths. The words are addressed to Job and to all his heirs. By saying this, I don't wish to suggest that these speeches address our modern situation or justify its horrors, only that they may provide something to consider at an unsayable edge where a new spiritual anthropology is birthed for one who can hear the voice hidden in the whirlwind. What might that be? Perhaps this, that Job's heart is imploded by unanswerable questions, by questions that unman him and all the pretensions of language, but which also offer him a new beginning in an incomprehensible vastness without measure. True religious language addresses the soul directly and makes a claim. whether this is precisely specified or not. In the present situation, Job is suddenly induced to see the world and divine providence from a totally non-human perspective, even though the divine speeches are addressed to him personally and in terms taken from the human sphere. A barrage of questions is put to Job, all bearing on the divine creation and its sustenance through the strong pulse of life. Granted, Job cannot be brought to any originary consciousness. Who could be? But he can be called to trial for his presumptions about the nature of things. And so he is urged to consider the wild ass in the wilderness, the ostrich which abandons its eggs, and the eagles that eye carcasses from on high and descend to pluck their bones bare. There are also awesome creatures from legendary times to consider, gross mega monsters who swallowed the seas and snorted trees long before humans walked the earth and deigned themselves the pinnacle of creation. All told, one thing is clear. Standing upright and having insight or being perplexed about the meaning of life is hardly the heritage of all creatures. But all beings are creatures of God. One can say nothing about the hot-blooded horse or the cold-blooded reptile except that they are and persist with their own onto-vitality. Sensing this, Job falls on his knees, his mind unloosed by these matters, and proclaims that hearing of God is not enough, for now he sees clearly and must say, Nichamti al afar va'efer. What does this mean? For one thing, the verb nichamti is bivalent, and so I believe that it was chosen to express two fundamental insights. Taken in one sense, the phrase has Job say that he, quote, relents or divests himself of prior presumptions, since they were expressed by a creature of dust and ashes, a mere mortal. This meaning thus refers to the new consciousness that Job acquires and his awareness of the limited human capacities for explaining suffering. The mortal mind is born of dust and ashes, and Job expresses an existential awareness of the limits of human cognition. I would call this realization epistemological and characterize it as epistemological humility. A second meaning of the phrase highlights an entirely different valence of the verb, nichamti, and suggests that Job now expresses, quote, compassion for all the creatures of dust and ashes. How can we understand this? What was the impact of the divine speeches upon Job that elicits such a response? One possibility is that Job perceived the great fragility of human life within the flood of existence enunciated by God, and such an insight evoked a new ontological sensibility, which transformed his attitudes towards suffering and induced a disposition of compassion for all human creatures similarly fragile. Both interpretations ring true. But I would like to suggest two other possibilities for the term nichamti. In the first case, Job, quote, relents of his presumptions concerning how God relates to creation or the nature of divine providence. Hearing God present the vast surge of his creation, Job realizes that life is vitalized in innumerable forms, and that each and all express God-given providential gifts. Call this their creaturely verve, or means of survival. And so Job relents of his presumptions of how God cares for his creatures. He realizes that God gives all creatures the capacity to endure in unique ways. The second explanation may be revised accordingly. Instead of suggesting that it was Job's realization of human fragility that elicited his new compassion for other human beings, I would suggest that Job draws moral consequences from the display of life presented by God. For if crows have their distinctive ways, as do ostriches and horses, what then is distinctive about the human creature? This question hangs in the intervals of the cosmic vision granted to Job. One possible answer is that, in contrast to most other creatures, whose élan vital is bent on their drive for survival, humans are often vitalized by the values of creature care, as is evident in their frequent readiness to endanger personal survival for the sake of values, and to put themselves at risk on behalf of their fellow creatures. This realization that values constitute a core feature of humanity, along with the capacity to interrupt primary drives, is, I suggest, the insight that grounds Job's words of compassion and conditions his newborn moral minimalism. We can see this through Job's subsequent actions. For immediately after asserting compassion for all creatures of dust and ashes, Job prays for the friends with whom he had contended and acts on their behalf. Significantly, his ritual deeds are not induced by either anxiety or compulsion, as were his earlier works on behalf of his children, but are now totally grounded in forgiveness and creaturely care. I would add that Job's new orientation and God's forgiveness of him are simultaneous. Life is now founded upon a new moral minimalism, compassion. It is the one thing needful. Job derives this insight from God's display of the vastness of life. Hence, no natural theology is expressed here, but a theology derived from the depths of God's created order as a divine truth. Beyond cultural forms of good and evil, but fundamentally in their service, the book of Job rejects theologies of retributory justice and reveals a new spiritual center point. It is a heroic point, whose center is everywhere and nowhere. For those with an eye and heart of humility, it will be found in all the life forms in the great divine vastness, whose rights derive from their status as entities in their own right. This is a truth that recognizes do's and don'ts in the depths of God's creation and submits to these imperatives with a worldly wisdom. But let us not forget that this insight derives from the book of Job. It is thus an assertion of Scripture for the sake of a renewed theological and cultural life. Perhaps we may build on it. In this hope, I offer my final reflections. A third reflection. Level 3, the theological self. The challenge is now to speak of God, not just of a God beyond being, without attributes, beyond mind or mindfulness, but of God whose attributes conceivably thread the fabric of existence, whose potentials for justice and mercy with potentials for justice and mercy in the human world. This is a God who may somehow be brought to mind and thought. Granted, these thoughts are formulated in human language and spawned by our mortal limitations. They thus bespeak a divine ontology in human terms. And this realization makes me ask, is it possible to consider such formulations in a way that comports with our contemporary philosophical sensibility? And if so, how might this particular sense of God command or constrain human action? For an answer, let me return to the book of Job and the climactic moment which depicts the rebirth of Job's soul through a divine maieutic. I begin here because Job is such a pivotal text, not solely because it explodes the pretensions of self-centered theodicies, but because Job is himself a paradigm for a reborn subjectivity. Job's disposition changed because he heeded a call that challenged his consciousness to the core. Brought to the brink by aporias posed by God, These impossible and heart-boring questions reconstituted him as a person. How did this new subjectivity find first expression? By an act of confession. Not the lamentation which fills his outburst in chapter 3, when he contracted in pain and wished never to have been born, but by the expression of radical humility, followed by an act of human care. Job is reformed by a new disposition and the acts derived from it. He received the world into his soul in one ecstatic perception, and this vision transformed him. True, the images are parceled out in serial facts, but his response attests to an immediate grasp of the great diversity, filled with pulsing life forms and sustained by God's gifts. Job succumbed to a new consciousness and a new ethic. But with this act of confessional self-emptying, it appears that Job has transcended words. How then can language help us beyond what these divine speeches may inspire or evoke in our modern minds? Can we go further? Can we build upon this literary model and ourselves attain a new theological consciousness, one that may sponsor a moral disposition capable of perceiving forms of yes and no latent in divine reality? Job is an exemplar from antiquity. How might it be for us? Here is a possibility. It is my own pivot point, the sacred center where my modern philosophical sensibilities and the truth of tradition transmitted by Jewish sources converge. This, then, is my narrative in briefest terms. Words and language rise to consciousness from ineffable depths, shaping our world and ourselves simultaneously. These human locutions and their phonemic potential all derive, as it were, from the infinite intonations of God's name, parsed in Scripture as I shall be, as I shall be. What might this formulation suggest? Perhaps that all such intonations are the creative ground of all world being. Utterly inconceivable as such, they generate the myriad possibilities of existence which we try to conceptualize for better or worse. Thus, God's shall be includes the hidden paths of light in thunderstorms, the harsh frost and tender dew, and the veins of life and earthly ore, not to mention the words that name them or call them to mind. Listening to the wordless word shall be vibrating through existence, people of the Jobin type shudder in silence, for they perceive in this great God saying traces of a most sacred semiology, infinitely encoded in the swirl of things. This new theological consciousness may also induce a sudden awareness of our primary ontohermeneutic condition, namely, that there is no meaningful existence for humans which is totally unshaped by the resources of language, however we conceive it, and that this language conjoins with our eyes and ears to formulate the many shapes of our world. And just as there is no human existence unmarked by modes of language, there are no shapes which prescribe how reality must be seen or in what form. Our terminology changes the morphology of experience, as does our perspective. Overwhelmed by this realization, we sense with a new knowing that we co-constitute our world through the very God-sprung language which constitutes us, and that all our hermeneutic acts derive from the divine depths and inscribe human forms in the infinite ether. And then, possibly, the human truth of the tremendum may somehow claim our hearts, and our soul is reborn. Insight now guides our vision, and a new awareness accrues. Of what does it consist? Perhaps that ever and always, the hidden but omnipresent God informs being at the very borders of human experience and thought. At such moments, graced by insight, a hint of God's godhood perceives our being, and the holy vastness has a name, shall be. But we must still ask, how may this transforming consciousness inform our moral will? My answer begins with a passage from the Jerusalem Talmud, which undoubtedly arose from profoundest meditations. According to it, some sages pondered the nature of the primordial Torah and wondered how it was written in its preternatural state, before material elements. Most wondrously, they suggested that it could be likened to shapes of black fire upon white fire. This image inspired millennia of Jewish mystics to speculate how this Torah might be read. For if the Torah is from God, an expression of God's godhood, what are the semiotics of that inscription? Should we read the black configurations against their white background, or the white configurations against the black ones? And if this spiritual hologram is somehow true for the primordial Torah, perhaps its earthly manifestation might inspire a related contemplation, namely, that the black letters provide a foreground sense of human meanings necessary for our personal and collective lives, and requiring the white background for them to be perceived and make sense, whereas the inverse perspective reveals a greater plenitude of possibilities, the infinite and unsayable divine revelation that is intoned by God's saying of his name, I shall be as I shall be. This other inscription, unreadable as such, is the creative effulgence of divinity, radiating through world being, while also concealing an infinite more beyond being. Perceiving this oscillation of forms, black and white, in profound simultaneity, the human being becomes conscious of all the idolatrous possibilities that may result when words are perverted or conceal God's unimaginable truth. Another teaching, now from the Midrash, takes us further and suggests what's at stake when people do just this. The legend states that when Moses descended the mountain, he beheld a travesty below because people could not endure the period of his absence and filled the gap with an image of a bull called their God and Redeemer. Utterly overcome, Moses dropped the heavy tablets with the divine words written upon them. Why? Because the holy letters could not witness this great perversion. And so they flew upward to heaven, leaving Moses with big chunks of matter, which he could hardly hold. And so they fell down and broke apart. This scenario, as a parable, suggests that it is precisely our spiritual values that make the physical world bearable and transcendent, and give it a transformed character. The shattered stones are thus the earthly remains of a deadened spiritual life whose potential was squandered. To what may these texts be compared for those who seek orientation in the vastness? Perhaps to the ability to live with integrity in the silent depths, aware of the white spaces and the primordial configurations at the heart of all possibility. This is the spiritual challenge, which also precedes the transformation of that awareness into moral action and sensibility. So how might this moral disposition be cultivated? One way is through a meditation on the very conjunction of the black and white configurations of Scripture or other texts, so that the spiritual seeker might perceive the white reality through the lattice of human language, and thus elicit a God consciousness as an infinite and holy shall be. This awareness, practiced as a spiritual exercise, may then give birth to a soul humbled by the fragility of language and to a sense of restraint in the way we use words. Taken further, this realization will also affect how we respond to the pulse of existence, enhancing or protecting the surge of life that surrounds us. And then the oscillating ground of black and white, symbolizing human and divine expressions, may also bend our heart to hear the words of yes and no at the foundation of things, and the need for utmost care when assessing how our evaluations of worldly claims upon us should be translated into human and interpersonal norms and values. The God-given, all the a priori conditions thus depend upon human beings for many modes of its realization and flourishing, or for preventing the bounties of this God-given life from corruption and decay. Thus, if the word yes signals our affirmation of God's creative shall be, so ever given, even without our merit, a primordial no is also inscribed within it for the human heart to hear. This is the great rabbinic warning, Bal Tashrit, do not destroy the fragile life forms of the world for God's sake. Is there more? Does God's will prefer one earthly thing to another? Are there even some unassailable absolutes? Certain religious traditions and many political schemers seem to know for sure and say so in their own terms. Their contrary presumptions sometimes leave us with dueling dialectics, competing for exegetical truth about whose life can be tampered with or even deserves death for righteousness' sake. May heaven protect us. Demented and deluded, these claimants to God's truth even proclaim perverse and triumphalist readings of the most exalted formulations of our scriptural heritage, as when Leviticus 19:18, truly a great commandment, is read to say, "You shall love your neighbor who is like yourself." With this semantic twist, the teaching is transformed from a high-minded imperative into a mirror of low-minded narcissism, proclaiming to all the wicked queens who ask that only they are the fairest in all the land. Is this not the self-consuming cell of moral cancer? So let us take a breath. What we can surely know from our own experience and human examples is that within the divine mystery, some souls are reborn and perceive deeply into God's good and rest with a hard wrestling claims for serving life in all its multiplicity. Some of these people chisel the whirlwind into tablets of Torah and proclaim these truths, and this is a lot. Founders like Moses formulate primary instructions for themselves and their heirs. But white fire ever burns at the edges of the letters of life. And so new souls arise who offer revised formulations of the old instructions based on creative interpretations for the sake of the good. And still others come forth in the same spirit and introduce words and forms hitherto unknown. Their lives and works are also precious. We have to align ourselves with the goals of this righteous remnant. Persons whose dispositions of sympathetic care respond to the latent resources of God's good, however and whatever it is, and cultivate it as a heavenly law of goodness for the sake of our moral souls. And where might expressions of this good be found? Expressions which may command our attentive regard. Where may we perceive its latent forms? First and foremost, I believe, in a discerning heart, in one that bends heedfully and with attunement to the world in its many life forms. There is no better way, I think. And so, to underscore my point in a poignant way, let me leave you with a brief narrative, as reported by the linguist Roman Jakobson. It transcends its telling like a parable and goes like this. Once a missionary went into dark places, believing its people in need of his light. And so, armed with his Bible and a bag of tricks, he went forth. Suddenly, he saw many people before him without clothes, stark naked. Horrified, he recoiled and gestured at their exposed bodies. "How can you do this?" he exclaimed. At which point, they pointed to the skin on his face, bare flesh, without cover or concealment. "But that's my face," the man proclaimed. "Ah, yes," said the others. "But for us, everything is face."
Let me put it in slightly different ways. I think there's a twofold inscription. the world can be read as an inscription, and then it's incorporated as a kind of internal palimpsest or internal text. Texts themselves also become palimpsests of the self. And the self embodies them through action. And those become, in part, the moral expressions of what we have internalized by text. Fortunately, enough things happen in the world that challenges the text that we've internalized, which may have taken us in a bad direction. And then that cycle has to keep going on. Judaism calls that the oral tradition, which keeps. If that's what we talk about today, is that self-correcting mechanism. But this is, Judaism is founded on the embodiment. But it's the embodiment of these texts, which only have significance to the extent that they're lived. If they can't be lived, there's no sense doing exegesis about them. We can't do anything about them. So the whole tradition hangs or falls by the status of the lived nature of the words that are studied. They're not hypothetical. And they have all the debates in the Talmud in all these instances are what are the implications if you follow this form of logic or that form of logic? Because it has consequences if you're a strict constructionist or a loose constructionist. And the same thing is what's embodied in the body when it acts out rituals, which are simply correlates to some of the moral teachings, or ideally so, at least in the tradition that I am part of.
Thank you for a most eloquent and remarkable talk, buddy. I wanted to ask about the repeated refrain in the talk of the heart, that your ethical system and your theological anthropology seem to have a very, very strong role for the human heart. And I was wondering if you could exegete that a bit in terms of your own thought, and also perhaps say some things about moral education vis-a-vis that heart, and how that heart matures, so maybe, develops, etc.
I mean, well, just to be brief, so since we're using scripture, so Psalm 51 is an interesting phrase called the homely bee. It's called readiness of the heart. The whole task in all rituals, at least the spiritual tradition of Judaism, is the cultivation of readiness. The cultivation of readiness to do the ritual correctly and the cultivation of readiness to respond correctly. And it's for that reason that certain forms of what we call mental dispositions, which throw a person off, means what the rabbis say, they don't have yeshuv hadat. There's no balance or sobriety of attention. They're being cast around by this. So the key issue is lahachim, lahachon libi, this preparation. And that is the softening of the heart. Because in this sense, in both in the biblical and the rabbinic tradition, the heart is a form of mind or mindfulness that can think and feel and absorb. So that is, if I were then to answer your question more personally, it's all about the cultivation of readiness. I mean, what's the status of any of the religious traditions if when it hits the ground, you screw it up? Right? So if it's of anything, it's for the cultivation of readiness. And what that moment is, you don't know. So you sort of hope that you'll be ready. Or, as some of the masters would say, that if you screw it up, you can catch yourself faster than people who don't cultivate it. So it's finding your balance even after you've talked. But that's what the whole, ideally, that's what, and so that's all of what moral and spiritual and religious education, that's what all the interpretation of the text is about. Not just factual knowledge, it's what Moses by calling the matzah, kind of knowledge is power. It's in the craft. It's not, that it has to be transformed into a living power and force. And that's only done by this preparation of readiness. So all the teaching of the tradition is to act it out on the assumption of those forms of life, embodied in light and mind, enhance the goodness of life. They bless the creation. And where they don't, that's where other generations scream of perversity, really arise. And fortunately, younger generations do that very well. And that, you wouldn't go on, you didn't break the tradition, you could go on. But the holders of the tradition can't tolerate that. Because it holds all those forms of readiness. So that is what it, that describes. So this form of moral education is to try to get things from the text into the body, the poem says. The body becomes an independent layering of the text that one can then have access to. And that's what it means to be a person of the tradition. Otherwise, it's just books on the shelf and that's so.
On this layer, can it occur differently in different persons? And how do you mediate between the core of the tradition and the diversity of the tradition? If you want to go further, how do you mediate with, let's say, other traditions?
I've been talking about these minimal points. So just having a ready high is a minimal point. It's a minimal point. That's what students of the tradition would have to discuss. What is the center point? What can be a center point? What can have maximal possibilities? And then that will allow for the greatest, what you talk about, the flourishing. I don't, it's not coming down together. So it's in there, it has to be reassessed as a balance. It's an internal balance point, a balance point in the tradition. And you sort of know it as you live it, I suspect. But it's those are the things that if you go back over the entire spiritual tradition, that are at the core of the meditative traditions, largely what all the exegesis is about. If it isn't, then it's just going to be a little pyrotechnics, which traditions like the religion. I get paid for doing everything. But it's not at the core. Right? There's actually one image, and since we've had Montfield, there is actually a very interesting essay that was never published by Rabbi Soloveitchik called Ben Adam Kisei for a Human Being. And in that sense, he's talking about this deep interiorization of that language. And of course, the reason for that is all the more profound. A human life takes precedence over a whole story of that thing. So this becomes the true scroll. So I don't think when we talk and we talk about religious things together, that center point is what's in the background in all these cases. So it just has to work as moral, as a moral balancing point. And I think that's what people can share. And that's really, I think, this education is. Since it's almost Passover, Jewish tradition, they should be asking questions and doing things. I've been endlessly impressed by my grandchildren and how my two sons discuss the weekly Torah portion on Friday night. The custom, they not only report to your parents every day they begin during the week. That's just factual knowledge. But then there's a kind of moral implication that has to be discussed. And the discussion doesn't rest than just reciting the narratives. It inevitably, the parent will ask, what do you do in this circumstance, using a text as a kind of model? It's not that there's right or wrong, but they have to realize that it wasn't just enough to come home with the details, but it has to have a place in an enactment. And then the kids struggle to do that. That's what they do, and then they do it. So, you know, so then on a birthday, they decide that all the presents will be given to poor children in the hospital. And they make those decisions. And they say, so the tradition is working. What's the balance point? But then it's working, right? Then it's working. So it's a Jewish and Christian and Islamic traditions are huge, but they have centers. And that's the precious.
Yes, thank you very much. I'm really interested in this first level of underwritality, because it seems as if the moral education comes from, well, I always want to say feelings, or, you know, a lot of our discussions today have been about law.
See, I was, that underwritality is just the thrust and drive to survive. Keep on going, or to even throw all kinds of innumerable meanings. But it's only as that interpretive stance that is turned into what I call the ontohermeneutic.
Yeah.
And only that place of reconfiguration, you have to come there, that's why I said you have to come to that place first before you decide how you turn these things into values and norms in the world.
Yes, so that dialectic of the ontovitality with the ontohermeneutic is the hermeneutic. Interpreting what some people might call feelings, when you use the word senses.
Well, they both deal with feelings, but I was trying to show the difference between what happens when you're just a natural self, and then you're a cultural self. Yes, the cultural self learns about God from traditions, written and oral traditions. That third one was when we were trying to break through to something more primary, when it's trying to talk about God. It's not like you couldn't use this language, but it was trying to layer the one on top of the other.
Yeah.
And they obviously can be talked about differently, but I think it helps one see oneself both as a natural being and all of its possibilities, and the natural possibilities, and then what you can say when you absorb all that through cultural texts, and then the issue of breaking through that, which was that third level.
Yeah, no, it's very helpful. I guess it's the ontovitality that intrigues me, because someone might say about a natural self, oh well, the natural
self. Well, I was trying to say also that the cultural movement is the dialectic between ontovitality and not. But I'm just beginning to think about this.
Okay, so it's great, thank you.
Well, thanks very much. I was wondering if you'd reflect on the horrific possibility of his evolution from a theological self back and through the cultural self, trapped into the ontological power. In other words, is there a way in which the lecture is also a hermeneutic of the kinds of regressions we can see in a culture and in ourselves and traditions where the final word just is vitality?
Sure, because that is that sliding back of fear, not being able to stand in that emptiness where the letters escape. So I talked about the highest thing as a heroic possibility.
Right.
It's not like you live at that level at all times.
Right.
There's a phrase at one place in the morning religious service that really says some of this we're talking about. And all it says is that I hope that I won't be ashamed of how I live in the tradition. Because you can slide back. So I can't speak to that. I mean, everything in my life, probably everybody who's in this room, is trying to help you with that. And I think that's partially why one of the sub themes all the way through was not just affirmation, but restraint. Right? Scripture begins with restraints. don't want to say you don't, but that was an ongoing sub-theme, because restraint is a major issue for people to understand what you can't touch in all kinds of senses.
Sam? Thank you for the really great talk. One of the things that I'm interested in what you're saying is the sort of affirmation of perplexity. That on some level you suggest that we have almost a moral obligation to sort of sustain a kind of perplexity, that when we try to manufacture certain kinds of lenses to eclipse the gaps and the caesura in text and in life, that can have really great moral consequences. And you also suggest that there's, at least in our time, if not in Job's, a sort of comfort personally in perplexity. The word nikamti also can mean I'm comforted now after this monologue of perplexity, of not knowing in ways that actually...
I wouldn't call at the end as perplexity. That's a great moment in the silent conundrum.
So
it's not even a joke. The perplexity is with all the hermeneutical rant.
So that I'll put tremendum and perplexity under a greater category of caesura.
The perplexity is these attempts to resolve these gaps and caesuras. But Job breaks through to something else.
Right.
I guess that's beyond complexity. And it's that consciousness that then can become the source of moral action. At least that's what's trying to suggest. At least through this text. That's why this text is also powerful. It's not only a powerful text of reborn subjectivity, but it's a narrative, it's a human narrative that's describing a divine presence, but it's a fictive narrative. There's nothing in the text that purports that this, it's a narrative of revelation. It's not revelation as such. It's all within the framework of a human attempt to use these resources.
Then there's a breaking through.
All right, thank you. Thank you so much.
One more day, folks. Tomorrow, talking at 9:30.
We thank you for listening to or viewing our podcast. For more information and for other podcasts, please see our website, divinity.uchicago.edu/podcasts. Copyright, the University of Chicago Divinity School.